Thank you, madam. I would like to start off with thanking Ceylon College of Physicians to give us the opportunity to share our knowledge, and also our president, madam, Dr. Dhammika Gunawathana, to give me the opportunity to share my knowledge on erythrocytosis, what we know. So today's talk, I will be briefly introduce the topic on erythrocytosis and also the causes of an erythrocytosis and how to investigate an erythrocytosis. So before I move on to my talk, I would like to start off with a history, how this polycythemia and the erythrocytosis have come up. So the Prof. Henry Beckwith, he is a French physician who has first described a polycythemia vera in 1892. So where he has described a patient with polycythemia syndrome not due to cardiopulmonary disease. As we all know, cardiopulmonary disease can be associated with erythrocytosis, but here he has found something is unusual. So that was the initial workup or initial reported case is came in the literature. So after that, there were a few additional cases have been described by William Osler in 1903. And after that, as we all know, there will be a detection of JAK2 V617F mutation that has been changed the whole world into myeloproliferate neoplasm. So in 1950, before that, I would like to introduce the word myeloproliferative neoplasm. So that was actually came up to the literature in 1951, who is Dr. William Demeshek, who has included PV in his conceptual classification of myeloproliferative disorders. So now we use the word as myeloproliferative neoplasms instead of myeloproliferative disorders. So in the 2005, where the discovery of JAK2 has changed the world, as I have mentioned earlier also, so which have explained or ratified the Demeshek's concept of myeloproliferative neoplasm. There are so many papers or an article on discovery of JAK2, so I have given some references here. You can go and have a look. So after that, in 2007, additional mutation in JAK2, which is exon 12, has been detected because almost 95% of polycythemia vera patients had JAK2 V617F mutation, but there are 5% of people who have had the morphology and the clinical picture similar to polycythemia vera, but they didn't have a typical JAK2 V617F mutation. So later on, this gene sequencing has been done on JAK2 gene and there was a detection of exon 12 mutation. And also this is the history of how the polycythemia vera has come up in the literature. But there were several reported cases of erythrocytosis in relation to underlying diseases, which we call that as a secondary erythrocytosis. So compared to the polycythemia vera, the primary bone marrow disorder, the secondary erythrocytosis are very much common and we see day to day in life. So I'll go into my topic, the introduction of erythrocytosis. So the word itself is a self-explanatory. Erythro is a red cell. Cytosis is an increase in cells. So it manifests as a raised hemoglobin concentration or a hematocrit, or we can use pack cell volume. Ideally, to prove that there is an increased red cells, we have to do the red cell mass estimation. But that is very cumbersome and with very cost, so we don't really do a day-to-day practice. So we use the surrogate marker, hemoglobin or a hematocrit, to show that there is an increased red cell mass. So I will be talking a lot on the hemoglobin and the hematocrit, not the red cell mass, because in the day-to-day life, we go with the hemoglobin and the hematocrit. So in the packed cell volume or in hematocrit, as we all know, if you take 100% the whole blood, So we'll get roughly about the packed cell volume or cells which contain roughly about 46%. So that is a normal packed cell volume or a hematocrit we expect in an adult. So but with an increased PCV or a hematocrit, so it can be either true or an absolute increase. So that means if there is a real increase in the red cell mass or a volume, then we call that as a true or an absolute erythrocytosis. Whereas there is no increase in red cell mass, but when you see in the full blood count, you see the increased PCV or a hematocrit. So that's purely because reduction in the plasma volume. So which in this picture you can see, if there's a volume is reduced, then that will mimic your PCV is high. So then we call that as a relative or a apparent erythrocytosis or a polycythemia. So the etiology classification, as I mentioned, we classify the broadly the true polycythemia or a true erythrocytosis or the relative or apparent erythrocytosis. So it's a further classification of true polycythemia. As we know, there is an increase in red cell mass. It could be primary or it could be due to secondary. Or there is a separate entity called idiopathic erythrocytosis, where we exclude all the primary and the secondary causes. Then we conclude that as a, if we can't find any underlying causes, we conclude that as an idiopathic erythrocytosis. So in the primary classification, the polycythemia vera, so which is a myeloproliferative neoplasm, is a clonal disorder, and there is an inherited conditions which called primary familial and congenital erythrocytosis also comes under primary polycythemia. So I will be dealing later the causes according to this etiology classification. So before that, why we should know the erythrocytosis? So why should we study about it? Or what is the importance or the clinical significance of erythrocytosis? Purely, as we all know, because this small percentage of this erythrocytosis can ended up having polycythemia vera. So that is because we have to really investigate the patient or a person whoever comes with a high hemoglobin or a hematocrit, because purely for detection of myeloproliferative forms. So why the importance of looking or detecting the myeloproliferative neoplasm? Because it's associated with one of the risks is a venous thromboembolic disease. Not only venous, it can present with arterial thrombosis as well, like stroke or MI, they can present with that. So that is one of a key complication of having a polycythemia vera. And moreover, this disease can transform into either myelofibrosis or acute myeloid leukemia. So because of those things, you wanted to detect the polycythemia vera as early as possible. And also, we have a magic drugs with us, which we can control the disease and we can prevent them getting a morbid thromboembolic phenomena. So that's because we want to identify the small group of polycythemia vera. So the prevalence of polycythemia vera was 22 per, if you take 100,000 population. So very rare, but it has a very dangerous or a very complicated complications. So purely for that, you wanted to investigate if somebody comes with a high hemoglobin or a hematocrit. So what is the definition of erythrocytosis? So there are two school of thoughts regarding the cutoff level of hemoglobin and the either packed cell volume or a hematocrit to suspect the erythrocytosis. I think this is the few more slides which is coming up is very important for you all as a clinicians, because the patient comes to you first, and when you see the full blood count, you will get alarm saying that, oh my gosh, this patient having a hematocrit of this and hemoglobin of this. But for that to say, you should know what is the cutoff level. We have to beat alarm and alert. So in the 2008, the World Health Organization, there's a classification system for myeloproliferative neoplasms, which got revised in 2016. There were a few changes in the cutoff level for hemoglobin. I will go in the next few slides. And the British Society of Hematology guideline. So basically, we have WHO criteria and the BCSH, or the British Society of Hematology guideline. So in the 2008, World Health Organization, they have given one of the major criteria is the patient should have a high hemoglobin and the hematocrit. So why this cutoff level is came up, because they say if the red cell mass is more than 25%, it goes up from the mean normal predicted value, then that is significant. So which it will be predicted by our surrogate marker hemoglobin and the hematocrit. So that's because this level has come up. So the hemoglobin of more than 18.5, and you have to remember which it's in relation to patient sex, whether it's a male or whether it's a woman, the cutoff level is varying. So if it's a men is above more than 18.5, where the hematocrit is equal to 55.5%, or for a female, more than 16.5, the hematocrit is 49.5, then you have to beat alarm, because that's if that particular person has more than that cutoff level, that is fulfilling one of the major criteria for to diagnose the polycythemia vera. So you have to alarm at that point, and you have to send the referral to hematologist and say, oh, look at this, what this patient is having. So that is one of the point that you have to get alarm. And I'm not going through these each and every criteria, because I think it's not relevant for here, because I have put here just to show this cutoff level, how it has got varied later on. So in the guideline of the British Society of Hematology, so which was published in 2018, is a recent one which we have, where it showed the patients with the persistently raised venous hematocrit is more than 52% for a male and more than 48% for a female. That's roughly equal to the hemoglobin of more than 18.5 for a male and 16.5 for a female. So which is more or less the similar to our WHO criteria. So initial days, we actually accepted that this cutoff level to use in the clinical practice, saying that if somebody comes with this hemoglobin or a hematocrit above this level, you should do a proper referral and you have to seek a proper advice from the hematologist and rest of the workup. So what happened after that? In the 2016, the WHO has revised its criteria, where it showed hemoglobin is more than 16.5, which is for a man, and the hemoglobin of 16 for a woman, or the hematocrit is 49% more than that for a man, and the 48.8% for a woman would do for investigating the erythrocytosis. So which is, there is a, for a man, there is a drop in hemoglobin by 2, because its initial, it says like more than 18.5, now it has dropped to 16.5. So why they got revised their criteria? Because there are a few internationally recommended research have happened, and one of these is a masked polycythemia vera, which came up from this international study. So where they have said there is a and also there's another study, polycythemia vera from new and modified diagnostic criteria, because there is a certain quite significant percentage of people have been missed by using, having a polycythemia vera has been missed by using the previous criteria. So here, which I have highlighted here, roughly about 14% of patients who actually had JAK2V617F positive mutation, but their hemoglobin and the hematocrit is not fulfilling the criteria which have been laid by the WHO or a BCSH. So this is quite significant number of patients have been missed out from the diagnosis. So if we have missed these patients, then they will come up with all the complications and might come with a transformation. So that's because the criteria has been changed, and in the 2016, they have said we have to have some low threshold to pick up these people, like hemoglobin of 16.5 for a man and the hemoglobin of 16 for a woman. So in the revise, but the BCSH, the British Society of Hematology, they kept as previous one. So they didn't really change it. They kept it on the same hematocrit and the hemoglobin for diagnosing criteria. So after revising that, so there is an advantage, because as I have mentioned, we can pick up the people who belongs to MAST or a missed polycythemia group by keeping the low threshold for investigation. But at the same time, there are so many disadvantages also, because we usually see for the even with the secondary erythrocytosis, we commonly see the 16.5, 17 of hemoglobin and the hematocrit, and people started to alarm just seeing the figure of the hemoglobin and started to refer to hematology, saying that please exclude the myeloproliferative neoplasm, which where it's not indicated sometime. Okay, because in few more slides, I will be highlighting the causes for the polycythemia or erythrocytosis. Then we'll get to know what are the common causes we day-to-day life in our clinical practice we see. So there are disadvantages because it's a cost and the cumbersome for the patient, for an unnecessarily we investigating for the patient, taking blood and taking all the sort of a genetic test and things to look for without a proper clonal disorder. So actually in our practice, we are keeping still the standard of BCSH cutoff, like hematocrit is more than 52% for a male, whereas the hemoglobin is 18.5, and the female for more than 48% and the hemoglobin of 16.5. But in few instances where we bit relax on accepting the patient for investigating for polycythemia, even though their hemoglobin and the hematocrit is not to this cutoff values. For an example, if somebody is coming and you have excluded all the possible causes of the secondary erythrocytosis, then of course you have to go and investigate that patient. So what I'm trying to say is, if you see somebody who is coming with less than this cutoff values, you can get the detailed history and examination, even you can work it out for looking for any secondary causes. Then if you couldn't find anything, of course, then you can refer to us to look for any primary disorders. So still we are using this cutoff. So I think it's worth to remember this, what the cutoff that we are currently practicing here. So then we'll move on to the causes of an erythrocytosis. So this is the from the guideline, the diagnosis and the management of polycythemia vera, where they have given a causes according to the etiology classification, which I have showed before, the primary and the secondary, where it's an inherited and the acquired conditions. And this is also more or less the similar, which I got it from one of the textbook, is Postgraduate Hematology, which is the 7th edition. It's recently came up. So that's also nicely given all the possible causes for the person to get the erythrocytosis. So primary, so mainly the congenital, as you all know, something is wrong with the red cells, like there's mutations, and acquired is a polycythemia vera, which most of us are worried about it. And the secondary is a congenital again, and again the acquired causes. So here you have to know this list of secondary causes of secondary erythrocytosis, which is the commonest cause that you all come across. So the simple, even in the history taking and then examination, you can exclude most of those secondary causes. So that is very important before you jump and refer. If you just see the full blood count and referring to that patient to the hematology is pointless. We'll also do the same workup again with the history and the examination. So I'm not going through one by one here the listers, but I think it's worthwhile to know the list of causes for secondary and the primary. So it's a little bit about the pathophysiology. I'm not going into detail because it's going to be the boring the section of here, the pathophysiology. But polycythemia vera, the problem is the autonomous production of the red cell. There is no control over the production because of the mutation, the genetic mutation. So the mutation, the V617F mutation and then exon 12, both in the pseudokinase domain of JAK2 gene. So usually they are the genes held for the inhibition of production of red cells when there is a overproduction. But if those genes get mutated, then there won't be any inhibitory for the production. So there will be an uncontrolled autonomous production of red cells will give rise to polycythemia vera. And also not only that, and the polycythemia vera erythroid progenitor cells are having an increased sensitivity to growth factor, not only the erythropoietin and also other growth factors as well, like interleukins and things. And the secondary erythrocytosis, again, you classify like whether appropriate production of erythropoietin or there is an inappropriate production of erythropoietin. So if the patient having chronic hypoxia, as a compensatory, you will have more HCl production. So that is an increased erythropoietin for some purposes. So that is an appropriate production of erythropoietin. Whereas in some tumor or some other like polycystic kidneys and things, there won't be any reason for the erythropoietin production. So it's inappropriate production of erythropoietin give rise to more and more red cell production. Again, that's also a problem for the person. So the inherited and the congenital erythrocytosis is problem. Then intrinsically, it gets overactive. So that's because you ended up having erythrocytosis. So the clinical manifestation, your patient most of the time is routinely we pick up the high hemoglobin and the hematocrit. So it's an asymptomatic because they do the full blood count for something else and then it's detected to be having high hemoglobin or a hematocrit. But otherwise, in your clinical practice, you would have seen patients who complain with a complaint of hyperviscosity, like headache, dizziness, and sometimes they come with a stroke or TIAs, then you do a full blood count and you have to see whether there is any erythrocytosis or not. And of course, this is a typical aquagenic pruritus is one of a typical presentation or a symptoms for polycythemia vera, because they typically describe after bathing, they started to having itching. So that is aquagenic pruritus, which is more towards the polycythemia vera. And not only the thrombosis, they can sometimes present with a bleeding as well because of abnormal platelet function. So stroke, yes, is a commonest way of patient present to you. And there is a hemorrhagic strokes, or sometimes they come with a GI bleeding. And these are other rare presentations like gout, and because of the increased cell turnover, or sometimes they present with an iron deficiency. So once you started to treat iron deficiency, then your hemoglobin and the hematocrit started to jump up and creep up. Then you alarm it and say, oh my gosh, for this iron deficiency I have treated, now his hemoglobin and the hematocrit have jumped up. Okay, so and sometimes they present with a gastric acid production with a peptic ulcer disease and things. So there are various way of presentation, but commonly in our day-to-day life, we see or we pick up most of the patient as a routine blood test, we pick up them having a high hemoglobin or a hematocrit. So how to investigate an erythrocytosis? So that's a big question to us. If somebody comes with that, what I'm going to do? So don't jump and refer to the hematologist in the first instance. So at your level, when you see the patient, you can start to work upon around him. So the erythrocytosis is a common reason. We of course get the referral, and usually it's a secondary origin because after taking history and maybe examination or after doing a preliminary investigation, we would have found, oh, this gentleman is having some secondary cause, not the primary. So that is a common way of presentation, the secondary erythrocytosis. And as I have mentioned earlier, the referral threshold for a very good iron storage patient is packed cell volume or a hematocrit is more than 52 for a man and the more than 48 for a woman. We still strict on that cutoff. So detailed history and examination are one of the crucial steps to identify underlying cause. So there is a proposed algorithm by British Society of Hematology to investigate erythrocytosis. It's nicely explained. I think it's not clear here. So I'll quickly go the stage one investigation and the stage two investigations. So before we order investigations, the history is very important. I'm keep on stressing again and again, the simple history taking is giving more information regarding that patient's erythrocytosis, age, and the dehydration, of course, which you can pick up easily, and the smoking. Then not just asking smoking won't help. You have to ask how frequent and how many cigars or what the smokes he gets per day and how long he's smoking. And of course, the alcohol history and the detailed drug history, because that is one of a commonest another cause we used to see. And also the sleep pattern, obesity patients, and any sleep disturbances, sleep apneas, whether they have those sort of histories, and any comorbidities, any history of congenital heart diseases. Obviously, you can pick it just looking at the patient. If come with a cyanotic heart disease, you can easily pick up them. And any previous history of thrombosis is very important. Not only it's help for the diagnosis, as well as for the risk stratification of polycythemia vera patient. And any constitutional symptoms suggestive for malignancy, because you can get secondary erythrocytosis associated with any malignancies. And the respiratory symptoms, of course, the COPD, whether the patient have any symptoms of that. And the family history of erythrocytosis is just to see any familial erythrocytosis running in that patient. And of course, the early satiety for just to see any splenomegaly and any evidence of hyperviscosity symptoms, because that is really, you have to attend that patient immediately if someone comes with the hypoviscosity symptoms. So examination, I'm not going through one by one here. So the height and weight is important just to see whether he's an obese patient and whether he's having any sleep apneas. And sleep apnea, of course, patients sometimes they can't tell. You have to ask from the partner who is a patient who must be knowing this snoring and things like that. And of course, cyanosis you can easily pick up. And the hepatosplenomegalies, any abdominal masses, and of course the cyanotic heart disease, and evidence of any chronic lung diseases. So the stage one laboratory investigation, which most of the things you all can arrange it at your level, for the full blood count and the blood film, of course the blood film we have to see it, but you can send it to us and we can have a look. And serum ferritin is very simple investigation just to make sure he's having iron replete patient. And then arterial oxygen saturation, just to make sure he doesn't have any hypoxic or a chronic hypoxic lung diseases. And liver function, renal function, erythropoietin level, serum calcium. And JAK2V617F mutation is a stage one investigation. Of course, that we have to arrange it from the hematology side. So for that, you can send us a referral and ask for it. So the further investigation, the stage two investigations, is depend on the results which you get it from the stage one test, and then accordingly you will ask some of the very sophisticated investigations. Of course, the red cell mass, which we don't do it here, and ultrasound abdomen is a very simple thing, you can ask for it, and exon 12, and like sleep studies and liver lung function test. And of course, you have to get a help from the hepatic team and the renal team to look for any causes related to erythrocytosis. You do these investigations especially when you suspect secondary erythrocytosis. And of last is an NGS panel, so that is next generation sequencing gene panel to look for congenital erythrocytosis. So I'll go through another, I think, three or four slides I have, just to quickly go through the treatment of patient with an erythrocytosis. Of course, this varies with the underlying cause for his erythrocytosis, whether it's a secondary or it's a primary. So I have started off with secondary because this is commonly we see day-to-day life. So hypoxic pulmonary disease, which is COPD or obstructive sleep apnea syndrome. So in COPD, erythrocytosis is defined when there's a hematocrit is more than 55%, and incidence is, you see, 6 to 8%, and obstructive sleep apnea, the incidence of erythrocytosis, you see roughly about 1.7 to 8%, so which is a bit of a significant percentage of people, they get it. So in the COPD, of course, you have to get help from the respiratory physician for the consideration of long-term oxygen therapy or alternative therapy to improve hypoxia. Because if you take it out that hypoxic dry, then erythropoietin will suppress, then you won't get the erythrocytosis. So that's a simple basic principle of managing COPD. Take it off the underlying cause, just improving his hypoxic condition. So, of course, if the patient is on smoking, you have to ask the patient to stop it. You have to strongly advise on that. And, of course, if the patient, though they have the erythrocytosis, because that is kind of a compensatory for them, but still, if they have more than 56% and if they have a hyperviscosity symptoms, of course, we want to take it off some blood by doing a venesection. So, in order to bring the hematocrit roughly about 52%, but don't bring it too much, because if you know in erythrocytosis in these two conditions, it's a compensatory, you need some support by increasing the red cell mass for the oxygen carrying capacity. So you don't really want to bring down something close to 45. So you want to keep it somewhere around 50 to 52. And of course, the obstructive sleep apnea, which you can manage with a non-invasive continuous positive airway pressure for reduced erythrocytosis. So simply in the secondary erythrocytosis, the basic principle is take it off the underlying cause, which contributing for the erythrocytosis. So cyanotic congenital heart disease, of course, they don't really recommend hematology to take a decision for whether to take it off with some venesection or not. It's purely depend on the cardiologist's decision. So always you make sure you get their opinion too before you touch the patient or taking some blood. So the post-transplant erythrocytosis, I think, is another commonly we come across. When there is a hematocrit more than 15.1%, more than for persistent for more than 1 month after the renal transplant, you call that as a post-renal transplant erythrocytosis. And incidence is quite 5 to 20% of people can have this post-renal transplant erythrocytosis. And usually they develop within a year of transplant. And it's a good thing is it's self-limiting. The patient gets spontaneous recover, maybe after 2 to 3 years time. But still, if they have some symptoms or if they have any problem having with an erythrocytosis, of course, you wanted to get some blood out by doing a venesection and target the hematocrit somewhere around 50. But otherwise, it's best management for post-renal transplant erythrocytosis is give some AC inhibitors, which will help to reduce the hematocrit order. So that's a good thing, which just giving a drug, you can reduce the hematocrit. And even not only the post-renal transplant, which we commonly see it, but you at the same time, you see after the stem cell transplant or the renal, combined renal pancreatic transplant also you see, which is quite significant percentage of people can get it. So the post-hematopoietic stem cell transplant, you have to take it off the blood by doing a venesection, try to keep hematocrit somewhere around 50. So the idiopathic erythrocytosis, this is our mainly I'm just touching the primary causes. Idiopathic, of course, I mentioned earlier the diagnosis of exclusion. And the only thing is you don't recommend the cytoreductive therapy, which we do with the polycythemia vera patient. So that is a bit slightly different from the polycythemia vera management. And mainly you give venesection and there is no well-recognized trials are not there to recommend how much the target hematocrit to keep it, but arbitrarily we keep it somewhere around 55. If patient had any previous history of thrombosis or you wanted to keep it a bit down somewhere around 45%. And the other thing is try to control the vascular risk factors like diabetic, hypertension and smoking, which easily we can lifestyle modification, which we can do it easily. And of course, you can consider giving aspirin. And congenital erythrocytosis, again, the low-dose aspirin. And venesection, of course, like you can give it when there is symptoms. Or if there's an asymptomatic patient who had a family history of having the same genetic lesion and had a thrombosis, you can target the hematocrit to bring it a bit down for this patient by keeping somewhere around 50. But there is a JAK2 inhibitor, ruxolitinib, also plays for congenital erythrocytosis, especially for HUS polycythemia, which we can consider. So polycythemia vera, as we know, low-dose aspirin we do give just to prevent thrombosis. And also the venesection, we try to keep the hematocrit target less than 45%. And of course, the cytoreductive therapy with hydroxycarbamide, which is one of a common drug that we use it in our clinic and in our patients. Again, that is depends on the risk stratification of polycythemia patient. And also there are other cytoreductive options too. For it depends on the age and what are the comorbidities. We can choose one of the cytoreductive therapy. And always you make sure you try to modify his other cardiovascular risk factors, because that's just try to prevent getting some thrombotic phenomena. And ruxolitinib, of course, you can use it as a third line or a second line of treatment for the polycythemia vera. If they have not tolerate or for the hydroxycarbamide and interferon, you can think about giving ruxolitinib as well. So maybe we talk a lot about the polycythemia because the prognosis wise, it has a 10 to 20% of risk over 15 years following a diagnosis of PV to progress to myelofibrosis. That is one of the dangerous thing. And other is it's a 20% risk over 20 years PV to transform to acute myeloid leukemia. But good thing is PV is most of the time we diagnose somewhere around 60s. Their age are 55 and 60s, so they have just 15 years, 20 years more. Nothing going to happen for those. But in a real practical life, the patients, they don't really suffer with myelofibrosis or the transformed AML because they die of natural death. So the take-home message, this is my last slide. Though erythrocytosis is a common reason for referral to hematological services, it is usually the secondary in origin. I'm keep on stressing that because it's a secondary causes which can be excluded or diagnosed just getting a detailed history and examination and very basic investigations. So the referral threshold for iron replete patients are hematocrit persistently more than 52%, where equally the hemoglobin is more than 18.5 in men and for more than 48% in women, except the few instances where the low threshold of hemoglobin is also used to investigate them, especially if patient had any thrombotic histories or whether his all the possible secondary erythrocytosis has been excluded from that patient. So the common secondary causes that we see day-to-day life, obviously the dehydration, smoking, hypoxia, and maybe the drug history diuretics. So please get the history properly and try to elicit these features. And the cause can often be identified from the, as I have keep on mailing history examination and the stage one laboratory investigations. Intervention is not always indicated, and decision to intersect is often made individual basis, and then underlying cause for his erythrocytosis. And polycythemia vera is rare, but only thing we worried because it's have an increased risk of thrombosis and progression to myelofibrosis or leukemia and requires specialist hematology management. Thank you.